عزيزتي إيمان، أنا اضطررت إلى ترك سوريا لأن ما دامت الحروب فيها والدم والمشاكل والمصاعب والفقر والقتل ولا عمل ولا دراسة والجوع متفشي. أعيش في لبنان طاقة البقاع مخيم عبد الرحيم. الحال عندنا في المخيم سيء جدا، لا خدمات لا عمل ولا نظام، المكان ليس واسعا. بيتي بسوريا كان جميلا، أنا مشتاق إلى رؤية بيتي الجميل، وكان بيت أحلامي الرائعة، وأنا الآن في الصف الخامس. أنا أدرس وأتابع الدراسة.
Give a very, very warm welcome to Ai Weiwei. Max told me for the first time about this very urgent initiative. It seemed very important, of course, to listen to Weiwei and his many experiences in relation to the theme of refugees. And I wanted to talk today, of course, about your film, but also about the seminar you're doing, the many researches you're doing concerning this theme. But before that, I thought it would be maybe interesting to talk a little bit more about the beginnings of you as a filmmaker, because I think in your practice there's of course always an extended notion of art which goes beyond an established field of visual art. It includes poetry, it includes architecture. We all know your practice as an architect. It includes curating, craftsmanship, it includes publishing, blogging, always activism, it includes collecting, many other activities. But I think this sort of aspect as you as a filmmaker is maybe not so known, and it's maybe important to know that this film doesn't come out of nothing, but it's actually something which started in the 70s. And I wanted to ask you to tell us maybe a little bit about your beginnings, because in 1978 you actually studied film.
Hi, it's nice to start a conversation with you again. As we have been doing this kind of conversation about a dozen times.
Yeah, for 20 years.
Yeah, we have been. So it's endless talk. And it's always nice to see you again here. And yes, I started I had a little film study. After Cultural Revolution 1978, I was among the first students getting enrolled in Beijing Film Institute. And that group of students later being called the fifth generation of Chinese filmmakers. It's about 100 students. And after Cultural Revolution, that means the university has been closed for over 10 years. There's simply no university opened during the Cultural Revolution. So we are first year of students to get into film school.
And then of course you did many films growing out of that. I mean, the first film I know about is a very political film you made about the SARS crisis. It was 2003, can you tell us about that?
Yeah, 2003, I started a photo kind of recordings in New York City. Also, I started to play a little bit with a camera at that time, but we never think to make a film. But till I went back to Beijing at 1993, and also has not much to do in Beijing. The time was quite depressing. So by 2003, suddenly a disease burst, like a SARS. So I don't know if people still remember, but in China was a big deal. Hundreds of people are dead, but more than the disease, because the government never revealed what really happened. So it's like a secret. So people feel quite scared when they don't know the reality, only knows a lot of patients in the hospital. And so we decided to make a little film about it. So that's really a first film we have done with my brother. The title of film is something like Eating and Drinking in Beijing. So because eating and drinking is very such a normal thing, but during the SARS, the restaurant completely nobody in there. There's nobody go to any gathering in the public area. It's very surreal, the whole city. So we decide to make a film to record that piece of history.
And then of course, soon after started the film about Beijing, and Oskar Kokoschka once said that it's kind of impossible to make a painting of a city, because the moment we paint the city has already changed. And so you made a very sort of multidimensional portrait of Beijing. It's 150 hours. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, that time I was deeply involved with architecture and also concerning about planning. It's a moment you do feel you can do anything, because Beijing is really, the whole China is developing. They need people to interpret city, or so I become an architect for quite some time. Nobody knows I'm an artist at that time. So I, after I built my studio, and that's the year 2000, I become totally involved with architecture. So that's before Beijing Olympics 2008. I realized the city is going to have facing dramatic change. So I started filming Beijing on a bus because I have to teach. So I told the university I cannot teach in campus. I don't like campus. So the school asked me, then how do you teach? I said I can rent a bus. So 24 students all sitting in the bus, so every day we're driving through the city. So I said maybe I should make a recording about the way we drive. So we divide the city the map, 16 pieces. Each day we drive through just one part, every street, you know, we marked. And we stopped there. So next day we start from where we stopped yesterday and then keep driving through the second part. So it takes 16 days to filming Beijing of every street. Beijing is quite large. So this is a street we see in the fourth ring, I think. And I ended up just one take, one keep going image for 153 hours. So I, after editing, I never have courage to watch it, because it's 6 days and more than 6 days, even a day and night, huh? And even you can watch the beginning, then you travel to New York, then you come back in 5 days, still the film is still running. it's like a ghost, but it just keep running, yeah.
And then you started to make films which have much more to do already with what you do also with Human Flow, which are films which are about research. And I mean, of course, the film which came to my mind in relation to that is the film about the earthquake, which is really a film where you did many interviews, you made interviews with many citizens. Can you tell us about that immense research you did?
But In the year 2008, China had many things happening besides this Olympic Games. The May 12th had a huge devastating earthquake. About 780,000 people disappeared just for that a few seconds of shaking of, you know, so the number is so shocking, and we heard this a lot of students, but the government never gave clear numbers how many people are disappeared. So that time I was very active on internet, already writing on internet for 3 years, and basically doing nothing but just blogging every day, and 2-3 articles a day. And so I said, suddenly I couldn't write anymore because people start to ask, why you're a frequent writer, why this past week you couldn't write anything? What's wrong with you? It was such a tragedy, because when tragedy happened like this, I feel speechless. I just don't have enough vocabulary. I don't trust my language. So I said I have to go to there and to know what really is going on. So that's so I bring my assistant Zhao with me to the earthquake ruins in the center of those Sichuan, and we went to many school. We see collapsed school. We see their parents. We see in the bodies and all those, because it's over 5,000 students disappeared. So that time. Of course, we always have a camera with us, so we made a film. Then we decided to interview all those parents. So we interviewed over 100 parents, and we on the internet, I made a kind of first social movement in China in communist society to do research on who is dead on this earthquake among the students. So. Yeah, the response is overwhelming. We organize the volunteers, go to those very remote area, door by door, village by village. So after 1 year of research, we found 5,200, maybe 19 students, their name, birthday, and which school they belong to. Why we are doing that? Because first, we think those information should be open. We need to establish a society which has this openness. And also, that reflects the corruption of the government, because the school building belong to the government, and they're supposed to build it secure. And that means they are not built it properly. But this research, for this research, we made two or three films. And of course, got me involved with a lot of conflicts with the authority. They start to feel I'm kind of incontrollable because I am always on the internet. And also reveal the new findings on my blog, so a lot of people read it. And it caused, as a consequence, a lot of a problem with authority later. Yeah.
And this sort of long research, of course, leads us then to the research for the human flow. And I remember the first time I was aware that you made this research in terms of the theme of refugees was actually when I came to your Berlin studio in January 2016. You had just started to actually work in the studio. You had received the passport, which was returned to you by the Chinese authorities after having been confiscated 5 years earlier in 2011. And when I came to the studio, there were many photographs, and you told me about the student workshop. It was before you started the film. It was really a trip you made to Lesbos to witness the impact of the refugee crisis. Can you tell us about how that began in 2000? Early 2016, late 2015?
Yeah, when before I had my passport, when I was still in self-detention in China, I already realized the refugee situation become horrible. This 2014. Then there's one possibility. I have to select the artworks from one refugee camp in Iraq for Venice Biennial of Iraqi pavilion. So that made my first initial contacts with refugees' drawings.
So you were invited to curate, to select?
Yeah, I'm kind of like a judge to select them. The foundation is from Iraq. She said maybe when you get involved, it will bring much more attention to the issue. So I looked at those drawings. Beautiful drawings, this made by adults, but it looks like baby's drawing, and with poetry, with very, very sensitive writings, and of course, I don't understand the words, but I know it's poetry, they translate for me. So that's first time, but we are not satisfied to just doing that. We always want to be more involved. So I asked the foundation, said, can I send two of my colleagues to the refugee camp. We do more deeper research about who are they. And she, of course, agreed with me. And we sent our colleagues there, and we videotaped over a few hundred refugees, more like portraits, each of them for 1 minute standing there. If you see the film Human Flow, at the beginning there's five figures standing there, the portraits come from that time. But we also designed a question net to ask refugees to write down where they come from, why they become a refugee, and what's the future, you know, what's the life in the camp. So I realized many refugees write down they want to go to Germany. I don't know why, you know, the whole world is so big, but they all write down Germany. So I didn't pay much attention till I have my passport. I come to Germany, I come to Berlin, and become a teacher in Utica. And that moment I heard some refugees already come to Berlin and from the camp. So I went to see them, and then I still don't know what to do, because it seems the situation is so devastating and so big. So I decide to go to Lesbos, where is most refugees approaching Europe the first. They landed in this island. So I brought my girlfriend, she is here, and also my son, who is over 5 years old that time. And I told them we will have vacation in Lesbos, this beautiful island, so they are great. But in my mind is really to see what is really going on there, because I heard this over 500,000 refugees already come to this beautiful island. So when we first day drive on the shore, and the volunteers who we had contacts told us maybe the past few days no refugees because the wind is too strong, the sea become too dangerous. So during we are talking, we see a boat right across in the sea. Our car right stopped in front of this boat. That moment is quite shocking. I cannot really use words to describe it. So we jumped down, then I started to use my iPhone to film those people, so many people crowding in one dinghy boat, you know, this kind of plastic boat, overloaded with children, women, and you know, people with unfamiliar face and dress, and you can see they have a different language and different religion. So that moment I thought, okay, why don't I move my studio to Lesbos, and we can really It's very much like a Sichuan situation. You know, I want to know more about it, you know, to touch the real life.
And I found the transcript here of, you know, the studio visit we made in January 2016. And it was also the moment when you started to then involve the students, because you had started to teach at the UdK in Berlin. And it's a small group of students, for about 15 students. And can you tell us a little bit how that sort of became part of the project?
Yes, at the same time I have to teach, I never believe I can teach anybody anything except I can involve them with my work, so they know how I work and how I would dealing with those situations. That's basically in China, in the old time, the teacher always functions like that. You know, you show people how you work on those things. So, and those students are quite, they really concerned about this refugee situation, and they all get involved. So I ask them to develop the skill, relate to what they're interested. And they all find their own topic and had some very impressive development during the past 2 years.
And I found in the transcript also something about, at that time there were some reports that you wanted to build a monument there, and you clarified that that was actually not the case, but still that you felt that it's important that there is memory, that this moment needs to be remembered. And I mean, Eric Hobsbawm talks about, you know, a necessary protest against forgetting. And of course, we kind of live in an age where there is more and more information and an explosion of information. But as Hobsbawm said, that does not necessarily mean more memory. So it might actually be that kind of amnesia is at the core of the digital kind of age. So in terms of that topic of memory, protest against forgetting, and your idea that it has to be remembered, can you tell us a little bit how that idea evolved since then? And
yeah, the mayor of Lesbos, he when he sent them there, he said, oh, why don't you help us to build a memorial for this island? I hesitate because I don't believe monumental things. So I think that, but I do realize the event need to be remembered, you know, the history need to be remembered. And so that time I think to make a film is most important, to leave a record for the history. And the film is a media which can work well on doing that. So that's how this human flow started.
And can you tell us also a bit about the research into other refugee crises? Because when I saw the research you did at the studio, there were lots of other, you know, documents you gathered on Vietnam, for example. You looked at different sort of refugee crises from the past.
Yes, I have this. I'm like a maniac about information, so I think if we only look at Syrian refugees, we couldn't get a right understanding about what refugees are about. So we set up a research team. We worked with UNHCR. We worked with people working in the government who dealing with refugees in United States or in Europe. Expert or books, and we set up a research teams in research whatever has been recorded for this topic in literature, poetry, and art through the earliest time, the Egypt, you know, the carvings on stone. Or the paintings, drawings in the Middle East, even the medieval time and later on. So it's a lot of topics about a lot of artworks, actually, about great artworks about humans movement. Or so we had actually three volumes. And one volume is dealing with artworks, hundreds of artworks in human history. And one volume is about literature, and another is about statistics, you know, the political analyzing. So those books as a foundation for we make this film. It's very important for us. One of the researchers you hear today, I saw, you know, we are very frustrated to get all the information that led us to much larger scale, and you know, not only in Europe, Greece, or but also to Turkey, Lebanon, Jordan, and Israel, Gaza, you know, also Afghanistan, Iraq, Pakistan, and Africa, and Bangladesh, and Mexico border. So, of course, it's not whatever we did is still very little, you know, very shallow. But at least it teaches me about what a refugee is about. So,
there's a quote here. Actually, there's an interview with you in the Atlantic, and one of the interviewees in the film says, being a refugee is the most pervasive kind of cruelty that can be exercised against a human being. So I was kind of wondering if you can tell us a little bit more about some of the encounters you know, you had, and some of the conversations.
In this film, we have 900 hours of film, which is you can easily the material can make many, you know, editing into many films, and we interviewed about 600 people, and so we went to about 40 camps in over 20 nations. So this is too many, too many encounters, and they all have very different story, but they all have the same story. And you know, none of them are willing to leave their home. Even they can be poor, or some can be even better off, but none of them are willing to leave the home. And they all had a peaceful life before they leave their you know, the home. So all the stories are sad, are beyond belief, and you know, it's you start to realize what kind of courage they have and what kind of hope they have to when they have to abandon their home and go so far away and to meet all those consequences. And
but also one thing which actually struck me is that, of course, the refugee camps, which you know, the film shows, are very often you know. Devoid of dignity, and is as Jonah Friedman says, there needs to be different form of architecture of you know, of in this sense of refugee sheltering or architecture housing, really, you know. That's and Jonah Friedman came up with models. He sort of drew possibilities how actually, you know, social architecture could work. Did you think about that in terms of your, you know, practice as a as an architect?
Yes, that's a very interesting point. As architects, I learn more from those temporary houses or very sharper houses than to learn from the museum buildings, because those houses, they have a very limited resource and a very almost impossible and to build. But since I also grew up in very poor condition, so very often we always use found objects or reuse or ready-mades to make a house. And why it's so beautiful, attractive, because it's so necessary. Everything is absolutely necessary. There's no anything is decoration. It's always you see the meaning, the usage of materials, which can be very smart, but But those things are very often you see in the refugees neighborhood, but of course not the camps in, you know, the same kind of tents. You don't see anything there. But if you see a refugee camp has been built there for some, has been 40, 50, 60 years, three generations. And those buildings, you know, it's a slum, but it's always, for me, it's very attractive to walk into a slum to see, you know, how people are dealing with their daily needs.
But it's interesting, really, how Jona Friedman, you know, proposes how architecture could kind of, you know, create or improve such, you know, architectural conditions. And I was telling Samia about this actually the other day, because he develops really proposals very concretely for Lebanon, how, you know, as an architect, you know, he could contribute to much better living conditions and things like that. One of the things I was wondering also is that, of course, the film is also biographical in the sense that you've been, you say in that interview here, in the same interview in The Atlantic, that you've been a refugee for most of your lifetime, because your father was basically beaten and exiled for 10 years when you grew up as a poet. And
20 years.
Yeah, can you tell us about that?
Yeah, my father was a poet. He passed away in 1996, but he studied art and poetry in Paris in 1930s. And he became the most well-known revolutionary poet. And that generation established the new nation on 1949. But by 1957, the year I was born, he was criticized as the rightist, in China the rightist, which is leftist in here. So there's about 350,000 intellectuals being sent to re-education. It's kind of labor camp. My family has been sent to the first location because he's like head of a writer's association at that time, the poet. And it's called Xinjiang area, near Russian border. And he spent 20 years in that kind of re-education condition, forbidden to write words. And during Cultural Revolution, which is about 10 years, he's in hard labor, and you know, it's extremely difficult even to talk about that kind of situation. So I grew up basically first 18 years is in the same kind of condition.
And of course, your father being a poet leads us also back to the film, because you told me that from the very beginning you wanted to have poetry also in the film. Can you tell us about that?
Just when you cope the situation which is in such a large scale and have such a very profound history, now today we call refugee, but refugee is a name just come not too long ago, before, you know, humanity, civilization is always move, it's always shifting from out of Africa, then, you know, it's always been shifting. So that's why the literature are so deeply rooted in those things. And the most beautiful thing about talking about those kind of topic is from poetry. We all understand poetry and literature is most powerful in coping and dealing with human conditions. So and also my father is poet. So when I was young, even in the most difficult condition, we still can read some poetry of his collection. So it does have some strong impact on my life.
And can you tell us about the end? Because there is this kind of final shot, which is basically a accumulation of many life jackets on the shores of Greece. Can you tell us about that final scene in the film, because it sort of takes the shape of a globe, it takes the shape of a...
Yes, The mayor of Les Falls introduced me to see this huge pile of life jacket. Those life jackets, when the Syrian refugees approached the seashore, they just first abandoned those life jackets. So those life jackets used to be all around this this island. It's like if you look from the top, you would see it's like a orange gold ring circled this whole island. That would be maybe 100 times bigger than crystal's installation. And if you walk on the shore, you see piles of those life jackets. And they all start to clean those life jackets to move it to one location, because that basically stopped the tourism in this island. And this island, their life depends on the tourist. And of course, then this daily you have news about people dying in crossing the ocean, you know. Sometimes can be hundreds are dying at the same time. So you see, sometimes you can see bodies floating into different locations along the shore.
Now, last week I saw your public sculptures all over New York, and that's also connected to the migration crisis, the project you did with the Public Art Fund. Can you tell us about that? Because it's in Central Park, it's in Flushing Meadows, it's in Queens, it's in Washington Square Park. There are all kinds of different interventions, also bus shelters.
Yeah, in past 2 years, we are mostly focused on this film, but at the same time, I have obligations to structure over about 10 to 15 museum shows and public sculptures. So I'm always trying to come out artworks in relating to the same topic. That's how I always do things, like, because that's what I am focused or I'm concerned about. So in New York City, when we have the chance to do this public art fund, I decided to do a work in relating to border on the fences or territory. And New York City is a city of all immigrants. And to work with public art fund, they are very supportive. The city is very supportive, the mayor and all those transportation and parks, authorities, they all become very, very helpful. So we designed over 300 works. Some are very small, like posters or banners, light pole banners, and some are quite large installations. And it's all related to one topic about fences and borders. And it generates a lot of discussion over this time. And recently, I see Trump administration build some kind of prototypes in Mexico border. So people say that's life imitated art. So, you know, it's kind of funny. You see those 8 or 10 prototypes, and
And there is also the silhouettes. I saw at Washington Square Park. I mean, the project is called "Good Fences Make Good Neighbors," and at Washington Square Park, there is a silhouette which kind of resonates with, of course, Marcel Duchamp.
Yes, we really like to make a fence in under this arch NYU campus. Because I used to live nearby on the Lower East Side, I often, you know, that's a location I'm quite familiar with. And that was a park more less like today, but more like people's park. So, but I had photos of Duchamp sitting on bench in the park or walking in the park because very nearby there's a chess club there. He used to play chess. And he had an art studio on 11th Street. So I used one image he creates 1930s for a surrealist gallery in Paris. The image of two person holding each other as a door.
Yes, but an entranceway.
Yes, yeah. As an entranceway. You can, but the idea of that gallery, the name of the gallery is a woman, after a woman in some kind of mythology story, you can really walk through a wall. You know, you have this power to go through the wall, which is good in our project. So that's how we.
And can you maybe talk a little bit more about what happened to these shelters, to these bus stops? Because of course, transportation is a key component of this whole conversation about immigration. And so I was kind of wondering if you can talk about that.
Yeah, we when this project started, we think we don't want to just do a sculpture in Rockefeller Center or in some prominent place, but rather to integrate the our works into the city. So the city as a facility or as instrument of the people. And it contains five boroughs, and the people take subways, bus, and come to the city, you know, ordinary people walking. And they would see those banners, and we did the structures in relating to bus station and posters to bus stations. So we want people to realize this a certain change, but of course they may not even know what is really going on, but they can sense the difference.
Now before I ask you my last question, which has to do with the sculpture here we've been all looking at, you know, all evening, I wanted to ask you the only recurring question in all our so far 17 interviews, which is, you know, the question about your unrealized project. I was wondering what in 2017 are your unrealized projects, utopias, projects which have been too big to be realized?
Not really. Now I'm doing a lot of promoting work for the film. I never realized after you make the film, the promotion of film is much harder job to, you know, I honestly have been going through over 20 locations, you know, could be different nations, and made 200 interviews, and I still have another 100 or 200 interviews to do. It's just to have to drag people to the theater to see the film. And I have to finish that. I never imagined it can be so hard, but that's what I choose to do, and I have to finish that first. Yeah.
And maybe to end, I just want to say again how urgent this KAYANY Foundation initiative is, and hope that you will all support it. And again, congratulate Nora and Samia and Max for this initiative. And maybe ask you as a last question to tell us about the sculpture which you contribute to.
Yeah, first I have to say because of the film I have a chance to meet the lady who initiated this school project. So I was so such a strong impact when we have to drive so far away to the Syrian border. And to see the camp basically forgotten, nobody, you know, care because so many things happening. And but there's nice school. You can hear people are reading books, which is like a miracle. You know, this in today's world, you still can see. You know, school is quite very elementary, very basic. Almost there's nothing in there besides those walls, but. When you walk into the room, you see teachers, sincere teaching students are really eager to read or to, you know, it's on the wall. On the wall, there's carefully decorated with students' work. So I was very impressed to see that today we still have people have a hope for the future generation. You know, we, in no matter how dissatisfied with today, we still think this planet still need the young people to later to become our future. So, you know, this is like our responsibility. About my work, this work is I have done in China quite some times ago. I had carpenters who is highest skilled carpenters. They have the skill like traditional Chinese furniture, which work made for the emperors. China have a profound understanding, the most profound understanding about how to dealing with nature, how to dealing with the materials in every aspect. It's far profound than anybody. I never met any, you know, I always go to museums in any nation, but I have to see Chinese craftsmanship have this highest understanding because their philosophy is much believe the human is part of the nature, so the understanding of the nature is most important. So the challenge to me is I have a bunch of very skillful carpenter, but I couldn't never find enough job for them, but I don't like them to go to the construction job because they use machines to cut and to use totally ruin everything. So I try always to find something which is very difficult to struggle to make it. So one day I found a plastic ball which my cat plays. I said maybe we make something like this. It's just trying to push them away not to come back like tomorrow, see what we can do. So I hired those very skilled people for past 20 years. But it's just trying to keep the tradition going. And that simple work takes them 2 years to figure out how to put it together. And it's not simply cut. If you look carefully, it's all joined by a hidden structure. It doesn't have nails, doesn't even need a glue. You know, it's really puzzled together and perfectly. So those things make them also very challenging and very feels interesting about their work because I always give them something they never did before. And also for me, it's really for myself to appreciate those kind of things. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And for those of you who want to know more about the earthquake, you know, research Weiwei told us, I recommend you go and see the excellent exhibition Alexandra Monroe, Phil Tinari and Hu Hanru have curated at the Guggenheim about Chinese art, which is on at the moment. Please give a very big applause to Ai Weiwei and thank you all very much.
Thank you. Thanks so much.